Hi, good afternoon. My name is William Neway. I'm an orthopedic spine surgeon here at OrthoVirginia in Virginia Beach. Nice to see everyone tuning in today for the webinar on cervical myelopathy. So we're going to talk about a very common condition in the cervical spine, which otherwise referred to as the neck. It's the most common condition within the cervical spine that causes cervical spinal cord dysfunction. So the definition of cervical myelopathy is a common form of neurologic impairment caused by compression of the spinal cord. So we're talking about compression of the spinal cord and not compression of the nerve roots. Last month, we've had a webinar podcast on cervical radiculopathy. So this is somewhat akin to that, although a little bit different because now we're talking about compression of the spinal cord as opposed to the nerve roots. So cervical myelopathy is part of a constellation of symptoms. There's other causes, arm or neck pain, that patients may come to see us for. With regards to the arm pain, they could have shoulder pathology, rotator cuff tears, arthritis in the shoulder. It can be peripheral neuropathies such as carpal tunnel syndrome, cubital tunnel syndrome, that can cause pain into the hand or the arms. On the other side of the spectrum, you have neck pain such as degenerative disc conditions. Kyphosis, which is bending of the spine, or scoliosis can cause purely neck pain complaints. And then there's a mix of arm and neck pain complaints, and that's where the spectrum of radiculopathy and myelopathy lie. So today we're talking about the cervical myelopathy, compression of the spinal cord. Some of the symptoms that you may experience if you have cervical myelopathy would be neck pain or stiffness. One of the more common things patients complain about is difficulty with fine motor coordination, difficulty with buttoning buttons or putting on jewelry. They have decreased hand dexterity, difficulty picking up loose change off of the table or out of their pockets. You can have balance, loss of balance, or trouble walking. Patients might note that they've recently started to use cane or hold on to furniture when they're walking around because they feel a little bit unsteady in their gait. They can also have numbness and tingling in their feet. And when it becomes more pronounced, you can have changes with bowel and bladder function. So I wanted to go over some of the MRI anatomy with you before we get into the actual causes of cervical myelopathy in terms of what it looks like radiographically. So here we have a mid-sagittal picture. It's a cross-section of the spine as if we kind of slice down through the middle of the body. And we're going to talk about four particular areas within this. In the middle, we have the vertebral bodies. Those are listed there in red. We have the disc spaces that are in between them. So you have the vertebral bodies, which are kind of the blocks in between, and then the cushions are the disc spaces. The spinal cord we have represented here in yellow, and then behind the spinal cord I've listed here in green. And that's important because this will be certain signs of or sources of compression within the spine. So on this one, it was kind of a subtle movement. Can we go back to the last slide and go back to this one? You can see in the middle, we have that disc that starts to push back. As the disc starts to degenerate and starts to be a little bit more incompetent, you can get thickening and pushing back of that disc onto the spinal cord, causing compression of the spinal cord. Likewise, you can have the same sort of compression, but coming from the opposite direction, coming from the spinal ligament. This ligament we have listed here in green runs the whole length of the spine from the base of the skull all the way down to the sacrum and the pelvis. And in some instances, you can get compression from both the front and the back and have more severe compression within the spinal cord. Again, when the compression has been either rather severe or has been protracted and you've had this long course of compression without any relief of that pressure, you can get a white line, which is represented here on this MRI diagram, which is the swelling within the spinal cord. That swelling represents edema or damage to the spinal cord, and sometimes once that sets in, it is irreversible. We've listed the normal MRI here on the left, and on the right we've represented what a picture of cervical myelopathy would be with that white line or the edema within the spinal cord. You can see the compression from both the front and the back where the discs and the ligaments are thickened and they push on the spinal cord. So cervical myelopathy causes a decrease in signals from the brain due to that compression, and that's what translates into those clumsiness and troubles with your gait due to that compression. Patients will likely experience a stepwise progression of their symptoms. They can be rather fine for any period of time, whether it's months or years, and they'll go along and not think much of it. They might have some hand numbness or some clumsiness in their fingers, and then for unknown reasons, without any sort of undue trauma, can have a worsening of their symptoms where they now require, like I had mentioned, a cane or a walker for ambulation, their inability to button their buttons or do fine motor tasks. And that's that stepwise progression that patients sort of experience. So the treatment of cervical myelopathy is functional based. So it's the level of functional impairment that is the most determinant factor when we're discussing surgical intervention. We kind of grade that into three categories, such as mild, moderate, and severe. We do that based off of a grading scale that we assessment we give patients in the office. Patients with mild cervical myelopathy may be watched and have serial physical exams with either twice a year or yearly checkups, can start in some physical therapy and be counseled on what to expect and how their symptoms progress. Patients with moderate or severe cervical myelopathy are going to be recommended to have surgical intervention, as that is really the only way to prevent and stop the symptoms from cervical myelopathy, since it's a physical compression on the spinal cord. So the goal of surgery is to halt the symptoms without progression. We do know that approximately 30 to 40% of patients with surgical intervention will get resolution and some improvement after surgery. Over that depends on the severity of the compression that the patients have on their spinal cord. Some other factors that will benefit the patients in terms of what likely lead to a better outcome would be early surgical intervention, younger age, patients that are non-smokers, and patients that are not diabetic. And so as we're talking about the surgical treatments of cervical myelopathy, it really depends on where the pathology is located. And that's how we determine what is the best and most appropriate surgery for the patients. If we think back to the initial slide where we had the compression from the disc, where the compression comes from the front of the spinal cord, we recommend an anterior cervical and discectomy infusion. If there's more compression from the back with that thickened ligament, we can recommend a cervical laminoplasty, which is a motion sparing non-fusion type procedure in patients without a lot of arthritis. If there's underlying arthritis, we recommend a posterior cervical laminectomy, where we remove some of that bone and tissue and then ultimately end up fusing that patient. Thank you. So, we gave you an overview of what cervical myelopathy is, what some of the signs and symptoms are, some of the treatments are, and I can take some questions now.
Thank you so much. So we will be answering questions submitted earlier and questions submitted live. Not all questions will be able to be answered, but we will get through as many as we can. Our first question is, can cervical myelopathy cause issues in the brain like migraines, dementia, or memory problems? Or is it only sort of things lower than the issue?
So patients with cervical myelopathy can get headaches. They can form into migraines of sort. They wouldn't be related to dementia or memory problems, problems with cognition. That would be more intracranial or issues with the brain. You're right in saying that it's more peripheral in nature. It's more with the upper extremity and the lower extremity. So more with the hands and the legs is where they experience symptoms. But certainly if they have a lot of underlying arthritis, they can have, you know, pain that radiates into the head and the neck, and that can cause headaches.
Are there any non-surgical treatments like physical therapy or injections?
From a non-surgical treatment, it depends on the degree of cervical myelopathy. So for patients that have mild spinal cord compression and their symptoms are not severe and that they are not, their reflexes are not abnormal, they're not experiencing any gait or walking problems, their hands are not having much difficulty with, those patients can be managed non-operatively and undergo physical therapy. There is some role for some stretching and traction. Injections would not help that situation. They can help with some pain control, but there's really no other treatment for cervical myelopathy, especially once the symptoms set in, other than surgical intervention, because it is a physical compression on the spinal cord and that needs to be relieved.
how is cervical myelopathy distinguished from other causes like cervical radiculopathy, which you mentioned earlier?
So cervical radiculopathy would be compression on the nerve roots as they come off the spinal cord on the sides out in what, if you look at your radiology report, it would be called as the foramen. So where the nerve exits through the side of the vertebral bodies, that will be cervical radiculopathy. That's more classically presented as pain in the arm or pain in the leg. They can have numbness and tingling and weakness. And there is definitely overlap between a radiculopathy and myelopathy. Although when it gets to the level of myelopathy from the compression on the spinal cord, then those patients would start to have more difficulties with gait, ataxia, things with their walking, problems with their fingers using, like I mentioned, using the zippers or picking up change in the coins, putting on jewelry. So fine motor coordination is limited when you start to get myelopathy symptoms. Those symptoms are not present in a radiculopathy. And as well, it's also noted on the MRI, we can see whether there's compression on the spinal cord or if it's on the nerve roots. And it's really the MRI that kind of gives us the diagnosis.
So you mentioned traction earlier as a treatment. So is hanging traction helpful for this condition?
Gentle traction in patients with very mild forms of cervical myelopathy can help. With any significant levels of compression, traction, or any type of manipulation of the cervical spine would be contraindicated.
Is an MRI required for diagnosis, or is just an X-ray enough?
An X-ray can give us part of the picture. It can show us the bony anatomy, which is what the X-rays are good for. But we really need the MRI in order to say for sure what the level of compression is, at what level the compression is, and how severe that compression is. That shows us the soft tissue. So the MRI will show us the discs themselves. It'll show us the ligaments that can be thickened, and it'll show us the spinal cord. None of those can be seen in the X-rays. Some of it is inferred based off of how much degeneration there might be at that level within the cervical spine or within the disc faces or within the facet joints. But an MRI is really the hallmark and the most important component for diagnosis. You can also make a diagnosis somewhat off of the patient's physical exam and their complaints. As we've said, they'll have abnormal reflexes, and you know, as they're describing their symptoms, that with radiographic signs of degeneration, you can be pretty sure that the patient is myelopathic.
Is the recovery after surgery different if you go through the front of the neck in an anterior procedure versus the back of the neck in a posterior procedure?
Yes, the recovery is very different. When you're doing it from the front, it's more of a muscle sparing procedure. So as we go through the front, the incision's typically smaller, maybe 1 inch to 2 inches. We go between the muscle planes to get down to the front of the spine and then remove the pathology to correct the deformity that's there or the compression on the spinal cord. And it's usually done through either one or two levels, depending on where that compression is. When it's done from the back, not as gentle to the muscle dissection, a larger incision, and definitely a longer recovery from that standpoint.
Can cervical myelopathy cause pain and numbness in your legs and feet, or does it only cause symptoms in the upper body?
So it can definitely cause pain and numbness in the legs or feet, although patients that have cervical myelopathy will typically have some sort of upper extremity complaint. So if it's purely within their legs or within their feet, more than likely it's coming from their low back or their lumbar spine. But if they have that overlap of symptoms in both the legs and the feet, then it's more likely coming from the neck.
Do treatment options change due to age? So if someone who's 30 has cervical myelopathy and someone who's 60 has it, would they have the same type of treatment, the same type of surgery, or is it different depending on the age someone is?
So the treatment for cervical myelopathy is the same regardless of age. Where the goal is to decompress the spine, and whether that's from, like we said, the front or the back, regardless of their age, the treatment's gonna be the exact same.
Someone asks, how long do I have to stay in the hospital after one of these surgeries?
Typically, if it's from the front and it's a one-level surgery, that can be done in almost an outpatient setting, an overnight stay probably at the most. If it's a multi-level procedure, meaning you have compression at 2 or 3 levels, as the number of levels increases, the length of the surgery in terms of how long the surgery takes and the recovery from being inpatient increases. A 2 to 3 level surgery might be 1 day, occasionally might be 2. Surgery from the back would be a little bit longer than from the front typically, just because of requiring inpatient care and therapy.
What are the restrictions after surgery? For example, can someone drive after surgery, or are they restricted from doing that for a while?
So patients are restricted from driving until they're able to have full motion of their neck, which typically is in 4 to 6 weeks. Before that, we initially place the patient in a collar after surgery, and then from then we wean them out of the collar as they're doing well within about 2 weeks. And patients are allowed to resume driving once they're off their narcotics and they have good motion of their head and neck.
Is robotic assistance used for these surgeries?
So no robotic surgery is used for spine procedures from the front in the cervical spine. There is some robotic procedure or navigation that is used when it's done from the back, and that's for placement of the pedicle screws. But in general, robotic surgery is more confined to the low back or the lumbar spine.
Can cervical stenosis lead to cervical myelopathy?
Yes, so cervical stenosis is another word for describing what leads to cervical myelopathy. Any compression within the spinal canal we refer to as stenosis. So if you have cervical stenosis, depending on the level of that stenosis, how much compression there is, can lead to cervical myelopathy.
So you mentioned that choosing anterior surgery or posterior surgery was related to where the compression is. But if there's compression on both sides, how do you choose which one to have?
Occasionally we do have to do it from the front and the back, and that's for that exact reason. If we don't feel that surgery, if you have compression in the front and in the back of the spine, if it is relatively severe from the front, we have to go from both the front and the back. If it's not quite as severe, if we feel that we can get enough compression and relieve that pressure from going purely from the back, then we'll go just from the back.
What is the recovery timeline for if somebody's had a surgery? Are they going to be spending months recovering? Do they usually get better with some symptoms right away? What does that look like?
So the recovery from the neurologic symptoms of cervical myelopathy generally take months, several months to 6 months, up to a year. You can experience recovery of your symptoms after surgery. It's generally not, it's a little different than a cervical radiculopathy. Whereas if we do the same procedure for compression of a nerve root, sometimes that pain, that radicular pain, that peripheral nerve pain is more instantaneous in terms of the relief. But the patients do experience and continue to experience relief of and resolution of their symptoms and improvement for months after the surgery.
Can massage therapy help in the relief of symptoms while patients are waiting to have surgery?
Massage can help with muscle symptoms. They have muscle cramps or muscle fatigue. It can help with that. If it's anything beyond muscle-based physical compression, is not going to relieve any compression on the spinal cord or those symptoms.
That is all the time we have right now. Would you like to close?
Yes, thank you for tuning in for today. It's been good talking with you about cervical myelopathy. If you have any questions further, I'm available for appointments Monday through Friday at the Virginia Beach office and on Tuesdays in Chesapeake. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.